ॐ स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतारवरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः. टुडे यू ऑल नो इट इज द होली बर्थडे ऑफ स्वामी शारदानंद जी. शारदानंद जयंती. शारदानंद जी वॉज वन ऑफ द आउटस्टैंडिंग मोनास्टिक डिसाइपल्स ऑफ श्री रामकृष्ण. श्री रामकृष्ण यूज्ड टू कॉल हिम एज ए बर्डन बेरर. लेटर ऑन मदर ऑल्सो कॉल्ड हिम विद द सेम नेम, बर्डन बेरर, भारी. सो दिस यंग मैन, ही वॉज, हिज अर्लियर नेम वॉज शरतचंद्र चक्रवर्ती. He was born on 23rd December 1865 on a Saturday in the evening 6:32 p.m. Because he was born on a Saturday, Saturday is considered not a very good day. Therefore, people were apprehensive whether his life would be smooth and good. But the horoscope was read by his own uncle, Ishwar Chandra Chakravarti. So he said, no, his horoscope is very good. He will be a very well-respected man in future. And we see the prediction of Ishwar Chandra Chakravarti proved true. His father was Girish Chandra Ghosh, Girish Chandra Chakravarti, and mother was Neelmani Devi. So he was the eldest son in the family. And he has a great, from the very young age, he was very much interested in puja, in worship, meditation, in spiritual practices. That is the elders would practice. And he was very calm by very nature. He was very, very calm, patient, and he had a very well-built body. And he loved nursing others. Anybody who was ill at home or outside, he had a desire to nurse them, and he would do it wholeheartedly. He loved serving others. That was a trait that continued with him till the end of his life. And for an example, one old lady, very old lady, she was affected with cholera, and she had no relatives, no friends. She was all alone living, and then when cholera is affected, she was absolutely desperate, nobody to help her. So in a very despicable condition. Then somehow this young man, maybe he was a high school student, he went and Shamavarda took that lady to a place on the top, open space over a building. Because cholera patient could not be kept anywhere inside, nobody would give any place. So perhaps in one of his friend's house, he took her to the topmost open. So she gave her some shelter there and put her there and nursed her until she passed away. And after passing away also, he arranged for obsequies. She took her to the cremation ground and they did whatever was done to her. Such was the his interest in nursing others, such was his great heart for the suffering of others. So, as a college student, he was a very brilliant student. He studied in a famous college, St. Xavier's College of Calcutta. The principal himself, one principal laughed, perhaps he was an Irishman. So, he taught Bible, seeing this brilliant boy, thinking that if Bible is taught to him, he may become a Christian later on. So he digested all the Bible. So he knew Bible from cover to cover, but never turned to Christianity all his life. Similarly, later on he became a member of Brahma Samaj. He did not become a Brahma Samajist also, because he was destined to become one of the foremost disciples of Sri Ram. Then after all these adventures, he first visited Sri Ramakrishna with a band of his gymnasium friends. He used to attend gymnasium to keep up his good health and do exercises. So with the gymnasium friends, they all thought, let us go and see this Paramahamsa, who is the Dakshineshwar. All young and old, they knew about this Paramahamsa. Each had his own interest of coming to Paramahamsa. The older people came to Paramahamsa for spiritual teaching. The younger people came to let us see what he is. Is he real Paramahamsa or is he only a hoax? So, with several attitudes, they came. He came along with a group of gymnasium friends. But then, at that time, he could not speak to Sri Ramakrishna directly, nor could Sri Ramakrishna address this whole group. So they must have just looked at him and then perhaps got a blessing from a distance. So they came away. Then he used to say, first visit did not produce any effect upon me. Then the second visit was, he went secretly to meet Sri Ramakrishna because his cousin, Shashi Maharaj, he also would visit Sri Ramakrishna. So each one wanted to keep it a secret by themselves. So he went in a secret to Sri Ramakrishna. And secretly, Shashi also came. Both were there before Sri Ramakrishna. On that day, in a strange way, Sri Ramakrishna started talking about the pitiable condition in spiritual field of the young people of Calcutta. He started saying, nowadays, young boys, before they develop love for God, they are all made to marry. And once they marry, they get into the troubles of life. How will the slaves face the troubles of life without the strength of mind, without dependence on God, without the faith that there is a powerful force that is leading all of us? So without proper bhakti, so one should not enter the world. But our young people are being pushed into this marital life when they are very young. So he was talking in the strain. So this conversation continued. Many people, they said, sir, then is it very bad to marry? No, it is talk between us. You don't worry about it. He told them. And that was meant for Shashi and Sharat Maharaj. To exhort them to hold on to their celibate life because they had great mission in their life. Then Sharat Maharaj was asked, Sharat was asked to come on Tuesdays and Thursdays. He selected Tuesdays. So every Tuesday he would visit Sri Ramakrishna. So Sri Ramakrishna used to teach him meditation, ask him to go and meditate. One day after meditation, Sharat Maharaj came to Sri Ramakrishna and said, I could not get concentration at all today. I tried very hard. I could not get any concentration. Is it so? Sri Ramakrishna called him and then put a dent between his eyebrows. He pressed his finger in between the two eyebrows. And immediately, Sharat Maharaj got a wonderful meditation. He went deep into himself and enjoyed a deep meditation. So Sri Ramakrishna taught him like that, meditation, prayer, concentration. One day, a conversation was going on in the presence of many devotees about Ganesha. Sri Ramakrishna had respect for all the gods and goddesses. So he started praising Ganesha, especially for Ganesha's love for his mother. Ganesha loved his mother. So Sri Ramakrishna was praising. He loved his mother so much. So he saw mother in every woman. Therefore, he did not marry at all. Ganesha remained a bachelor because he saw mother alone in every woman. So Sri Ramakrishna, as he was praising, immediately Sharat said, yes, I want to be like Ganesha. Immediately Sri Ramakrishna replied, no, you will not be like Ganesha, you will be like Shiva because traits of Shiva are in you. So what Sri Ramakrishna meant, we do not know. But later on we find traits of Shiva, taking the miseries upon oneself without any grudge, without any hesitation, and allowing other people to enjoy the life. So that was the main trait of this Swami's life. Wherever he would find misery, he would rush there in the form of reliefs, rehabilitation, and giving spiritual counsel. And just to give consolation to sick patients, he would go to serious sick patients, TB patients, and then would give them succor by speaking to them. Like that, he was the personification of Shiva, who is well known for taking away the misery of the world upon himself and allowing the world to be happy. That great incident of Samudra Manthana, churning of the sea. So when the poison came, then who will take the poison? Earlier to poison, so many good things came. Lakshmi came, and the white horse came, white elephant came, all the things came. They all, each one, quarreled for that one, took away. But when poison came, all people ran away. Nobody want to take it. So who will, unless somebody takes it, the next thing will not come. Then they approached Shiva. He said, come on, I will take all the poison. He took the poison so that the next things, good things can come. Others can enjoy. This trait in Sharat Maharaj was there. That is why probably Sri Ramakrishna said, no, you will not be like Ganesha. You will be like Shiva. So Sri Ramakrishna one day was in a very high spiritual mood. Sri Ramakrishna had hundreds of moods. In what mood he would be in what time? It was very difficult to say. So in one day he went into a mood. Then he said, I will grant all boons. Whatever people ask, I am going to grant that boon. So all people, devotees were there. Maybe these youngsters also were there. They went on asking, you give us meditation, you give us concentration, you give us purity, you give us... So many things they went on asking. So he granted all of them. But Sharat did not ask anything at all. He was simply keeping quiet. So Sri Ramakrishna himself was surprised. When all the people are asking, why is this young fellow not asking anything at all? He said that so many people are asking so many things. Why don't you ask anything? No, sir, I have nothing to ask. If you want me to ask something, then you grant me the boon that I should see Brahman everywhere. Let me see Brahman in every being. Then Sri Ramakrishna was surprised. But that is the last word in spirituality. You want to go to the highest pinnacle on the very first day. That is the last word in spirituality. I don't understand all that, sir, last or first. I want only that. I want to see God in every being. Then Sri Ramakrishna, in the high mood, he said, yes, you will get that mood, get that stage. So Sri Ramakrishna, Swami Sharadananda used to say later on, you see, his blessings have fructified. Now I see the blessings of him before me. That means he was seeing God everywhere. So that was the greatness of this young man. I want to see Brahman in all, he said. So one day, Sri Ramakrishna was praising Swami Vivekananda, Naren. So he was praising him. He is good in sports, he is good in music, he is good in studies, he is good in meditation, he is good in his character, he is good in everything, he is a perfect being. So after hearing it, this Sharat got very much interested. I must see this young man, who this is, whom Sri Ramakrishna himself is praising. So he went. But to his amazement and surprise, he saw that Swamiji was singing a Hindi song at that time. A Hindi song. Usually in those times, Hindi songs were all social songs. Social songs about social life and all that. Not a very high spiritual mood would be there. So Hindi songs were all dubbed as very worldly songs. So especially in Bengal, that Hindi songs were not liked at all. They would consider all Hindi songs are useless songs. And so when he went, Swamiji was crooning a Hindi song. Then he got a bad impression. This fellow, Sri Ramakrishna was praising him. So he is like an ordinary person, crooning a Hindi song. One of my friends was his great friend. he got detracted and went into bad life because of this fellow's influence, because he's singing Hindi song. So this was the first impression he got. But anyway, Sri Ramakrishna has praised him. Let me sit and talk to him. Then he started talking to Swami Narendranath. When he started talking to him, he got so much interested. So he would not leave him at all. So the whole day passed. There is a night, they started walking towards the house of Sharat. So they came and reached the house of Sharat. When Swamiji saw his house, he said, I see, Sharat, your house seems to be very familiar. Every room seems to be familiar. Every entrance to room seems to be familiar, as if I lived here for several years. So that was the intimacy they developed in a very short time. So afterwards, one day Swamiji wants to sing songs. So he found tabla lying there, but nobody to play. Then he said to Sharat, "Do you know tabla?" He said, "No, I don't know. I will teach you. You take the preliminary of tabla, and then you play the preliminary bowl," they say, just as say sarigama in music. So in tabla, the sarigama of tabla is called bowl. So I will give you the bowl, theka. Theka is the basic bowls. I will teach you this theka. You play theka and I can sing. So within a few minutes, he picked up this theka bowl and then he started playing tabla and Swamiji sang. Then Sharat Maharaj said, "I must learn this tabla well," and he became an expert in tabla later on. Later on, he also became a very good musician also, imitating Swamiji. Swamiji's influence was tremendous upon him. So he became a musician like him also. Later on, he used to sing to Holy Mother daily, and his voice was very sweet. So later on, and when he wanted to pursue his studies beyond his entrance examination, then it was Swami Vivekananda Narendranath who advised him to go for medical studies. So he joined the medical college. So when he came to Sri Ramakrishna, he was a medical student of first year or second year. So much was the strong influence of Narendra. They would spend long hours conversing, talking about spiritual life and about the greatness of Sri Ramakrishna. One day, Sri Ramakrishna was with Sharat, and he was talking to him. In the meanwhile, the father of Sharat, he came. Father of Sharat was very much worried. "Always my son is there moving about with the Paramahamsa. What will happen to his medical studies? He may not progress well." And then in those times, you know, people used to marry off, as Sri Ramakrishna has already told, in a very young age, the young boys. So his father wanted his son also to marry. So the father came and pleaded with Sri Ramakrishna, "Sir, when I ask him to marry, he does not want to marry. You ask him to marry, then he will marry." Then Sri Ramakrishna was in a fix what to say. In the meantime, Sharat Maharaj himself replied his father in front of Sri Ramakrishna, "Why should I marry? When I consider that marriage is good for me, I will marry. Just because Sri Ramakrishna asked that I will marry, I will never marry. So if I consider it good, then only I will marry." Then Sri Ramakrishna immediately said, "You see his reply, what can I say about this one now?" So yes, Sri Ramakrishna escaped from that. And another day, then the father thought, at least if he doesn't marry, let him stop going to Sri Ramakrishna. Therefore, how to stop him from going to Sri Ramakrishna? If I show him that there is a greater person than Sri Ramakrishna, then he will leave Sri Ramakrishna and come to the greater guru. So he thought, one tantric guru was there, Jagmohan Tarkalankar. So this Jagmohan Tarkalankar was a great scholar also and a great tantric sadhak also, and he was a guru to many people. So they all thought that he is greater than Sri Ramakrishna. So he brought Jagmohan Tarkalankar to Sri Ramakrishna, and there Sharat was also there. So he thought that Jagmohan Tarkalankar would argue with Sri Ramakrishna, and Sri Ramakrishna would fail in his argument, and then he would be proved that he is the inferior guru. Then his son would come away for the superior guru. But as soon as Jagmohan Tarkalankar spoke to Sri Ramakrishna, he was himself converted. He was so much impressed by the greatness of Sri Ramakrishna. Secretly he told his father, "Your son is lucky to be here, so let him be his guru, don't trouble him." So the opposite happened. He wanted to convince his son to go away from Sri Ramakrishna. But he got glued to Sri Ramakrishna more, because Jagmohan Tarkalankar also supported him. Then afterwards, Sri Ramakrishna one day, he wanted to train all his young people in monastic life. So he was already teaching them meditation, prayer, concentration. And then one day he said, suppose they become monks themselves, they have to go from door to door and beg, let them have an experience of that here itself. One day he said, all of you go with a begging bowl and then beg from door to door and bring the begged food. Then I will also take part. I will also eat some of that. Because begged food by the monks is very pure. You also go and beg and come. So Sharat also went as a beggar, so with a bowl in his hand. But you know, features were so good, strong, well-built and vivacious, full of joy. When he went and stood before a house and asked Bhavati Bhikshandehi, give me some alms. Then that lady came and then said, looked at him from head to foot. You look so strong, so well-built and so well-educated. Can't you at least become a conductor in the tram and then earn your living? Are you not ashamed? Come and beg. So, and see, he heard this. Anyway, she did not give him alms. He went to the next house and perhaps got some alms, came to Sri Ramakrishna. Then Sri Ramakrishna, he asked all of them their experiences. Then Sharat Maharaj told this, this is the experience I had. Looking at me, that lady did not give any alms, but she remarked like this, can't you become a conductor in the tram and earn your living? And that was the Calcutta of those days. He did not believe in giving alms to the beggars, because Englishmen did not like it. So they were so English fads, so they did not follow our dharma. Anybody who is a beggar, what are you going to give 1 rupee or half a rupee? So you simply give it and then forget about it. But these people are following the English model, so they did not want to help the. That is why that lady remarked like that. So Sharat Maharaj had, as I already told, he became a very good musician. He would sing. So the Sri Ramakrishna, after passing away, the Baranagar Mutt came into existence. So in the Baranagar Mutt, all these young sannyasis were there. So in the evening they would have prayer, and then they would have discussion, they would have study, and afterward, late in the night, they would start singing bhajans. They would start singing and dance, because it was a haunted house they were staying. Nobody was there anywhere around. The village was quite a little far. So they could do whatever they want. So in the late night they would sing also. Sharat Maharaj, his voice was feminine voice. So when people heard from outside, they could feel that some woman is singing there. So the villagers, though they are a little far away, they could hear the womanly voice. Then earlier itself they did not like these young people, 16 of them, wearing gherwan, moving about, those who could have been college graduates. So they are all wandering about like this, wasting their life. They were not very happy with them. So in the meanwhile, they got a ruse to punish them. They said, these fellows have brought some woman from outside. At 11 o'clock, they are having music and dance. And then let us go and catch them red-handed and punish them there. So several villagers came. They found the gates are closed. They jumped over the gates. So all of them, they came. And then they just peeped in and saw Sharat Maharaj singing. And all Swamis are dancing. And they became very ashamed. They cannot just run away because they have to jump the gate and go. It is not so easy to run. So in the meanwhile, the young people came to them. Why did you all come? They had to confess. So we got suspicious about you. Please apologize for that one. So they tendered apology. Then afterward, they never disturbed them. So such funny things also would happen. In 1889, Sharat Maharaj thought we should go for Tirtha Yatra, pilgrimages. So for pilgrimage, he selected one of the very difficult pilgrimages to Neelkantheshwar. Neelkantheshwar peak in Himalayas hill is very difficult to access. So very few people go there. Therefore, very difficult to find out the path itself, to enter and to come out also. Anyway, he as well as Turiyanandji, both of them, they went. So after visiting the Neelkantheshwar temple, and they were meditating there till evening, then when they started back, it became dark. So even in the daytime, it was difficult to find the way. In the dark, in the thick jungles, and the mountain path, so they could not find their way back. All around, the ferocious animals are there, the tiger, the bear, everything, anything could be there. And both of them are caught there. They do not know where to go. So they found two paths are leading, one to one this way and another opposite way. Then Turiyan Swami as well as this is the Swami, both of them, they thought if you go in the same way, both of us will be misled and we may be caught into some danger. Let us not go in the same path. I will go in one way, you will go in another. So that one of us, if he is on the right way, he will reach the village. Actually, another one will be there in difficulty. You can get help from that village. Luckily, Turiyanand Swami got into the right path. So he went and reached the village after a short while. But this Swami, when he went on walking, went deep into the forest. And he could not find any further way. Then he found the only way was to spend the whole night amidst all the wild animals there. Perhaps he could hear the roaring of these wild animals. So he said, when death is sure, why not meditate and take the name of God? Then whatever will happen, will happen. He sat for meditation and lost himself in meditation. So when he opened his eyes, it was morning. Then Turiyan Swami had brought some people to in search of him. They found him meditating. Then he asked, what is this? In the jungle where all these wild animals are there, you are sitting here and meditating. Said, what is there? When the death is sure, I thought, let me take the name. And by taking the name, let me die. But no, there was no death at that time. So somehow he was rescued. So such a risky pilgrimage he did. Another one time, he was traveling in Jamnotri, Gangotri, Jamnotri. And Jamnotri is steep. Steps, there are no practically steps. So long, steep path is there. From one rock to another rock, you have to place your foot and go. So they had to negotiate the difficult path. And he found one old lady was there in the whole group. She did not have even a stick. Perhaps she had lost the stick. Without a stick to get down, and being an old woman, it was the sure way to die. So he found, he had a stick in his hand. The same risk was in his case also. Anyway, he went and gave the stick to that lady. Mother, you take this use. Then she must have remonstrated. But he did not say, no, I will manage somehow. So this was the heart of Sharat Maharaj, putting himself into danger. He helped her and somehow he managed to come down safely. So this art of him was there everywhere, whether it was in the plains or whether it was in the jungles. He felt for the others' difficulties. One day, after their long pilgrimage through some jungles, etc., they saw a village. And then perhaps he and Turiyanathan both. Then, when they came to the village, they have to enter the village and afterwards approach the people there for some bhiksha. Then they will say, what they will say, they may say you come after 1.5 hours or 2 hours, If you want cooked food, they cannot give you just like that. So they will just prepare something fresh and then give you. So they were not in that mood to wait for 2 hours. Then suddenly a thought came into the mind of Saradananda. So Saradananda said, he thought, if at this stage, then we have nothing to eat, we have not eaten for so many, such a long time, and we are so hungry, we cannot wait until these people give us something to eat. If somebody can give us hot puri and hot halwa, then we will believe that Sri Ramakrishna is protecting us. Just imagine, testing Sri Ramakrishna. As soon as they thought, suddenly they found somebody carrying on his head both puri and halwa. Hot. He came and then gave it to them. Both of them were in tears. So then they enjoyed it. Immediately they remembered that Sri Ramakrishna is there, always with them. So this is how they had proof of Sri Ramakrishna being always with them. Then it was 1896. Swami Vivekananda wanted someone from India to go and help him. So he wrote that Sharat Maharaj can be sent as his assistant. So he was asked to go to London, where Swamiji would come from States, would meet him and then he would take him along with him. So in 1896, Sharat Maharaj left India to go to London. So he was staying in London in a guest house, where Swamiji also comes. So Swamiji started training him. You see, in the West, as you speak in India, it will not work. Here you must speak like this, in a slow way, so that people understand. And you should not move your hands and feet like that, as in India. So we move the hand in all the directions in the sky. So you should not move your hand. Simply hold your hand tight, just like a doll. You must stand and only your lips should move. You stand before a mirror and then practice this one. All sorts of training he started giving. Then Sharat Maharaj got very much annoyed. He said, no, I don't want all this training. Then if you don't want, go back. Why did you come here? You must take all this training. So one day Swamiji announced, without his consent, Sharat Maharaj's consent, that he will speak on the next occasion. And he had to speak, and he proved himself to be a very good speaker. So, and then he says, sometimes I thought, without telling Swamiji, I should run away from there. I cannot take so much of discipline. Anyway, he survived. And both of them then left after 2 months in London. They came over to America. So in America, in New York, Swamiji had his own friends, and he used to lecture there. He asked Sharat Maharaj to introduce him to some important people. So you will have to work here. So just after 2 months in America, then Swamiji one day called Sharat Maharaj and then told, Sharat, I cannot support you anymore. I don't have any money. So I'm myself being supported by other friends. So they cannot support you also. You go and stand on your own feet. Go and find out some hostess or host for you. There you start some classes for the children or do something and stand on your foot. Then Sharat Maharaj fell from the sky in a foreign country. He does know, he knows only a few people, and one of them was a lady, one Mrs. Wheeler. She used to come regularly to class of Swamiji, and Sharat Maharaj had become a little intimate with her, and he thought she is the only lady whom I can approach now. Then he is proposed. He said, now I have to stand on my own feet. Shall I stay with you and then start some classes around? Can you arrange for some classes? So then she said, yes, Swami, you can come. So he went to Mrs. Wheeler's house. So she was staying in a near place called Montclair. Then when he was opening his kit, so when he was opening his trunk, suddenly one photo fell down. That was Sri Ramakrishna's picture. Sri Ramakrishna's picture. It fell down from the bag, from the kit. And as soon as it fell down, Mrs. Wheeler saw that. And she was surprised and amazed. She said, "Well, Swami, whose picture is this one you are carrying?" I said, "That is my Gurudeva's picture. That is Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa's picture." "Is it so?" Then she said, "Swami, some years back, I had a dream. I was suffering at that time very much with some disease. So during the time when the disease became unbearable, then I saw a saintly person in my dream, and then he gave me some solace, and when I got up, I was cured. So I wanted to see this saintly person. I thought he must be from East, from India. So anybody, if any yogi or any spiritual teacher came to New York, I would run and see that, whether he is the same person whom I saw in dream." I did not see anyone. Whoever came, they were different. But I see this is the person who appeared to me in my dream. So Sharma was surprised. So he used to say later on, "You see, even before we go, Sri Ramakrishna has preached himself. We didn't have to go and preach. Sri Ramakrishna himself has preached." So he got there, shelter there. Then he started some children's classes. And just after 1 year and 9 months, Swami Vivekananda meanwhile came in 1897 back to India and started the Ramakrishna Mutt and Mission. So for Ramakrishna Mutt and Mission, he himself became the general president, and the president for Calcutta Center, he appointed Swami Brahmanandji. But who will become the general secretary? So he thought, this Sharat is the best man for this general secretary ship of this Ramakrishna Mutt and Mission. So he asked Sharat, "Come back from America. 1 year, 9 months are enough. You come back here and take this job, take this responsibility of Ramakrishna Mutt and Mission's general secretary." That is how, in 1897, when the Mutt and Mission was formed, he became the first general secretary. And this general secretary continued from 97 to 1927, 30 years. 30 years, perhaps he is the longest general secretary till now. It may be Guinness record. So he is holding the longest general secretaryship of his order. And he was very young also. When he passed away, he was hardly 62 years. From 32 years to 62 years, he was the general secretary. So when Swamiji came back, even when Sharat Maharaj went first to London also, he went via Europe through Rome, to Italy he went. So he went through Rome. And Rome is the place where so much, the very beginning of Christianity took place in Rome. Rome is the seat of Christianity. The Pope remains there in Rome. So when he went to Rome, he went into the Cathedral of St. Peter. We have also gone there. So there, in the Cathedral of St. Peter, there is St. Peter's place, where St. Peter's statue is there. And it is there where St. Peter lived his life and preached. And St. Peter was the first Pope. Jesus told, "I will found my mission on this rock." Peter means rock. So I found my organization on this rock. And that is how St. Peter became the first Pope. And when Sharat Maharaj went, Sharat Maharaj was called as one of the followers of Jesus Christ. Maybe St. Peter himself, we do not know. Because he had taken the responsibility of at the beginning of the Christian church. Here also he took the responsibility in the very beginning of Ramakrishna Mutt and Mission. So when he went into a high spiritual mood. So when he was in St. Peter, he was in a very high spiritual mood. Later on he said, "I almost experienced spiritual ecstasy." So when we went also, I remembered that. So I did not experience any spiritual ecstasy. What I remembered is spiritual ecstasy. It somebody has experienced here. It is a very inspiring place. Then, so he was called back. While coming back also, he again visited St. Peter's, Rome, etc., came back to India and accepted his position as a general secretary. Then, after taking up as General Secretary, and he, Swami Vivekananda was traveling around with Sister Nivedita, Holy Bull, Sister Christine, and other Western devotees all around India, mainly to instruct his new followers from the West about the culture and traditions and spirituality of India. Because Western people had a wrong notion of Indian culture, Indian spirituality. So Sri Swamiji wanted to give them a clear picture what Indian spirituality means and how every place is imbued with the spirit of spirituality. So in that trip he took Sharadanandi also. And where some many funny incidents took place. In 1896, when Swamiji in Kashmir, then Sharat Maharaj came. In 1896, Sharat Maharaj was with the Swamiji. Then Swamiji, both of them, they were moving about in Kashmir. Now, after 1897, when Swamiji has come, maybe 1898, so they were in Kashmir. Then, once they were traveling by a coach drawn by the horses, the horse lost the direction. It just started going down a gorge. And then the horse also fell down and died. And the coachman also fell down. And Sharat Maharaj also fell down. But even in that situation, Sharat Maharaj never lost his balance of mind. He was quietly sitting and seeing what is happening around. Then he found the coachman was suffering. He went and nursed that coachman. And then he was sitting there. Later on, other people came and helped people come out. Such was his calm bear. A calm mood everywhere. He would never lose that infinite calmness of him. Once it happened, another similar incident, it was much later when Swami Brahmananji was there in Belur Math. He was suffering from trouble, stomach trouble. So Sharat Maharaj said, I will bring a doctor from Calcutta. So he went to Calcutta. Dr. Kanjilal was there. Kanjilal was a very considerate doctor. He said, all right, immediately I will come, let us go and try to treat Brahmananda. So they got into a boat. So they were coming to Belur Math. So when they were in the center of the river, so there was a tempest. There was all water became choppy. So the boat was just wavering, went to sink. So in the danger situation, all people started crying, shouting. But Sharat Maharaj was calmly sitting, not only calmly sitting, he took out some cigarette and started smoking. Then, you know, the Dr. Kanjilal was there with him, he could not bear. What? Everybody is shouting out of fear for their life, and then boat is tossing like anything, any time it may. At this time, he's taking a cigarette and then smoking so calmly. He took out that cigarette and threw it away into the river. And then he said, what is this? You are making a big humor of everything. When people are all like in a panicky condition, then Sharat Maharaj coolly tells him, if not smoke, shall I jump into water even before the boat sinks? If the boat sinks, then I will go into water. Until then, let me smoke. Why do you bother me? This was the coolness of Sharat Maharaj. So, and another time when Swami Vivekananda had sent Sharat Maharaj and Swami Brahmananji both to Calcutta to do some odd job. They had to meet somebody and convince him, afterwards get some recommendation or some letter or something. But both of them could not do it. And when they came back, Swamiji wanted to report, what did they do? So when they explained, we did like this, nothing happened, so we could not succeed in our work. Then Swamiji was furious. What? This little work you could not do? This little convincing of a single officer you could not do? You seem to have no brains at all. So he scolded them very strongly. Anybody would have collapsed. And Brahmananji got up and went away. Then Sharat Maharaj was calmly sitting, going on hearing. So when the whole scolding was over, Swamiji himself was thinking, I scolded too much, I should not have done. He was himself feeling repentant. At the moment, the servant in the ashram, he brought two cups of tea. One he gave to Swamiji, one he gave to Sarat Maharaj. Then Sarat Maharaj took it and started sipping and enjoying it as if nothing had happened. Then Swamiji was amazed. So much of scolding after. He takes a coffee and then his tea and then he's enjoying it. Then he sold. He seems to be like a type of fish that if you put it on fire also, it will not die. So it will be there like that, living. So like that, this fellow seems to be never bele much, they say. Bele much. Even if you fry it, it will not die. So it will be just moving about. So like that, this fellow, so much of scolding also, cannot upset him. So the coolness of his head was something extraordinary, because he was a sthita prajna. So then, in Swami Vivekananda left for the second trip to the West in 1899. And he appointed, he requested Sarat Maharaj to carry on the training of the brahmacharis. So the Bellarmine brahmacharis had to be trained, they had to be taught Vedas, Upanishads, and the history of the country, and the spirit of service they have to bring in their life. All these things, you know, he used to train the brahmacharis throughout the day. And throughout the night, he would do japa meditation. No rest at all. So he went on until Swamiji returned after 1 year. So whole night meditation, japa, whole morning, the morning to evening, training of the brahmacharis. So he was invited to Bangladesh also. Everybody wanted to have this spiritual man. So Barisal was a very famous place, known for the freedom movement in the British period. So he went there. So he found that place inspiring. So when he was speaking to that audience about Sri Ramakrishna, he went into Samadhi. He became silent. So people thought, what has happened? Then they found him, he is in Samadhi. They had to wait for quite some time and he came down from Samadhi. So that was Sarat Maharaj. Always he lived in a high state, even being engaged in all the works of relief, rehabilitation and lecturing. So in 1900, he somehow thought that he should take Tantric Sannyasa, and then Tantric practices was not allowed by Swamiji himself. Swamiji had instructed that we need not follow Sri Ramakrishna in this, that his tantric sadhanas. Sri Ramakrishna has done it. So we should not follow, because you require a different temperament for that one, different training and aptitude for that one, which none of us have. Therefore, no tantric sadhanas will be followed. So he wanted to take tantric sannyasa. For what? He wanted to see Divine Mother in every feminine form. So he went and expressed this desire to Swami Brahmanandji and Holy Mother also. And strange, both of them agreed for that. Both of them agreed, all right, you can go through the Tantric Sannyas and the practices for that. Then to realize this, seeing Divine Mother in every female form. And Sarat Maharaj went through the ordeal. Then he could see God in every female form. He could see Divine Mother in every female form. So this was on one side his spiritual greatness. Another side, its expression, always cool head, always cool judgment, argumentative, logical in his working. And he could not get angry at all for more than a few seconds. He may sometimes get upset, but by the time you know that he has become angry, his anger would have gone. One day it happened in the Bellarmine. He went to the shrine and he saw on the steps of the shrine, so a lot of footmarks are there, black footmarks. That means this cook who takes the food for offering to in the shrine has not cleaned his leg. He has just walked without cleaning his leg. So all the footmarks are there on the steps, on the going to the first floor. Then Sharatmala Chandra said, what? Sri Ramakrishna's place, he's going without washing his feet. All that fellow, I'll scold him like anything. So then somebody went, they went to call him, then the cook came, but he took a little time. He took about 2-3 minutes. Perhaps he was doing something as a cooking. He had to get down the vessel from on the fire. Then only he can come. It took about 2-3 minutes for him. So when he came back, then he said, sir, did you call me? Then he said, yes, I called you. I wanted to scold you, but my anger has gone now. So without anger, how can you scold? You go, nothing is to be done. So this was the Sharat Maharaj, coolness and absolutely free from any anger towards anybody. In 1903, the burden of Udbodhan monthly magazine, started by Swami Trigunathitananda, also came upon him. Trigunathitananji had started this magazine, great difficulty. And then Swami Vivekananda praised him as one of the best karma yogis. Except a man like Trigunathitananda, who could not have started a magazine within an year, yet getting the press also ready. He purchased the press and he made all arrangements for paper. He arranged all for composing and all editor, collecting article for that one, all within 1 year, with the smallest budget. So Swami Vivekananda praised Trigunathitananda for very, very much for this one. He's a perfect karma yogi, forgot everything, even meditation and spiritual practices, to accomplish this work because I gave this work to him. So such a Udbodhan magazine. Then this Swami was asked to go to America by Swamiji. So after Swamiji's passing away in 1902, after a few months in 1903, he left for America. Then this magazine had to be carried on also, along with all the other duties. Then Sharat Maharaj took that responsibility also. Then he used to find that whenever Holy Mother used to come to Calcutta, she had to hire a house, and that the house must be near Ganges. Mother wanted to take bath in Ganges. Therefore, it should be near the Ganges, and it should be comfortable for another 3 or 4 of her assistants also to stay. So it was difficult to sometimes find such a comfortable house on hire. So he tried 2-4 years. Then he thought, no, we shall build one house comfortable for mother. Where was the money? There was no money for even eating. So he had only 2,700 rupees in his hand. 2,700. So with that, he said, all right, I will build this house. At that time, perhaps he had to spend more than 11 or 12,000 rupees. So another 10,000 rupees, who will give? He himself signed the paper, and then on his own personal risk, he took loan, personal loan, and then finished this house. And invited mother. Mother came in 1909. And from 1909 to 1920, 11 years, mother sanctified that house. She stayed there. And that house was called Udbodhan House. Udbodhan magazine was there on the ground floor. And the first floor was mother's house. So it was called mother's house also. Mayerbadi. Mayerbadi means mother's house. The first floor. The ground was Udbodhan. It was also called Udbodhan. So even now these two names are there. If you say Mayerbadi also, it means Udbodhan. If you say Udbodhan also, it means Mayerbadi. Both of them are there. But this building, he took loan on his own personal responsibility. He's a monk against all monastic rules. I don't know if Swamiji himself would have agreed. So he did it. And all the other people criticized him for that one. Both monastic as well as non-monastic. They said, you will not be able to repay this money. How are you going to repay? And you will be put into jail. You are going to end up in jail. All those things they used to ridicule him. He did not bother. I am doing it for mother. By mother's grace, everything will be all right. Then to repay that loan, he started writing his great book, Ramakrishna, the Leela Prasanga. The great master, Ramakrishna, the great master, It is in Bengali, it's called Leela Prasanga, the sports of Sri Ramakrishna. So, 5 volumes he wrote and published in Udbodhan. Because of his article, Udbodhan got great circulation. And then later on, the book was, it was published as a book. So, book also sold like anything. He could get all the money back. Then he repaid the loan. After repaying the loan, so he used to tell everybody, you see, everybody told me that I will go to jail. By mother's grace, I repaid all the loan. Mother has had a house also now. He was such a great, fortunate person to serve Divine Mother herself, building a house for her. And then, when this Leela Prasanga was written, where was the place for him to write? It was the Udbodhan press itself. The press was going on. There is, as soon as you entered the Udbodhan house, even now, that left that entrance, there is a small room. That's called Sarath Maharaj's room. He used to sit on the floor with a small table, desk like that. So he would keep like that and go on writing. In the meanwhile, visitors used to come. They want to see Holy Mother. So he has to inquire them for what purpose they want. Then afterward, he has to send them up. He had to give information to mother. If mother says yes, then they would go up. Then they would come down. So then next visitors would go. He had to manage like a doorkeeper. So he used to, was very proud to call himself, "Who are you?" "I am the doorkeeper of mother." So he was sitting just by the side only. He had to go to mother's place and the steps leading to mother's place. So many people sometimes, they would be very turbulent fellows also. One day one young man came. So he asked, Sarath Maharaj asked, why have you come? "I want to meet the mother." "Just wait, I will send word to her, get her permission, and then you can go." "I need not, I don't have to wait. His mother, your own. She is my own also. I will go." He just pushed aside. So Sarath Maharaj, who was a young man, then he went up to see mother. And he met mother. Then after going to mother, he felt repentant. "You see, I have behaved so badly with Sarath Maharaj. What will happen when I go back? I have to go in front of him only again." So he told mother, "Mother, I have done like this. What will happen to me? Now I have to go in front of Sarath Maharaj himself. Will he curse me now?" Then, "No, no, no. My children will never curse. You go, there is nothing wrong. You go." And then when he came down, so he was trembling. "What will happen to me?" Then Sarath Maharaj went and embraced him and then said, so he also apologized. "Sir, I did a wrong thing. I should not have been so rude to you. I am so sorry." He said, "No, no, no, there is nothing to confess. There is nothing to apologize. If you had not that anxiety to see mother, do you think you could have got mother? That is the anxiety, the thing that is important. You have exhibited very good. You come again." He consoled him, sent him back. And he would be sitting there, sitting in that most noisy place. People coming, going up, going down. And Holy Mother's attendants were there, especially Golapma was there. Golapma was a very vociferous lady. She would make so much of noise. So once Sarath Maharaj remarked, "If Golapma gives a little prasad to somebody, one coconut offered to mother, so if she gives one dab, that means coconut water, if she gives one coconut water to somebody, whole Udbodhan will know that she has given. So much of noise she will make." In that noise, amidst that noise, he used to sit and write this great book, the magnum opus of Ramakrishna, Leelamrita, Leela Prasanga, or the great master, Ramakrishna, the great master. So somebody asked, "So how did you write?" He said, I was not disturbed at all. Once Golapma was telling somebody, "Don't make noise. Sarath Maharaj is there, he's writing, you should not disturb him." Then Sarath Maharaj replied, "Golapma, Golap, you don't worry about me. I tell my ears, don't hear, and it will not hear. Any noise, let me go. Let it go. It will not disturb me. I will go ahead with my work." So that was the tremendous self-control he had, a yogi. And then the book, this great book of Ramakrishna, the great master, the biography of Sri Ramakrishna, Every detail of Sri Ramakrishna's sadhana is written. From the beginning to the samadhi, nirvikalpa samadhi of Sri Ramakrishna, and the post nirvikalpa samadhi, vijnana state, every detail he writes. So in the beginning, in the foreword, he wrote, "I have not written anything in this book which I have myself not experienced." That is the greatness of that book. The author says all spiritual states of Sri Ramakrishna explained. Says, "I have not written anything in this book which I have myself not experienced." But he did not write Sri Ramakrishna's death, his Mahasamadhi, he did not write at all. He closes with Kalpataru Day, January. Sri Ramakrishna passed away in August. So January to August, there is nothing in this great magnum opus of Sarat Maharaj. So somebody told him, "Why don't you complete it?" He said, "No. If Sri Ramakrishna makes me write, I will write. He made me write, I wrote. So I stopped there. If he asked me to write again, give me inspiration to write, I will complete it. Otherwise, it will be like that." That was Sarat Maharaj. In 1918, almost he was coming to the nearing his last years, one of the Swamis from Vrindavan came. And as soon as he saw the Swami from Vrindavan has come over to Belur Math, so Sarat Maharaj thought it is an indiscipline. So he has to work in the Vrindavan. Vrindavan were running a hospital there in those times at the beginning stage. So we have to work ourselves as nurses. We have to work ourselves as pathologists. We have to work ourselves as everything in the hospital, as brahmacharis and sadhus. At that time he has left Vrindavan and he has come over here without taking me permission. So Sarat Maharaj became a little angry. "And why did you come without taking permission from me?" He chastised him. But that Swami said, No, I have written you a letter. So it must have reached you. That's why I have come and you have permitted me to come." Then Sarat Maharaj was perplexed. He had already spoken to him harshly. Then he started searching and he found out that misplaced letter. It took some time. So when he found that misplaced letter, he felt very bad. "See, a senior Swami, without reason, so I have taken him to task. I am not fit for the general secretaryship." He went directly to Swami Brahmananda with the president. He said, "Brahmananda, Rakal Maharaj, you relieve me from this general secretary. I am not fit because I almost punished a person without any offense. So I should not have spoken to him like that. So I am unfit for this work." With great difficulty, Brahmananda had to convince him, No, don't worry. Anyway, you have realized that what you have done is wrong." He sent him back. He would not keep quiet even then. He called that senior Swami. So he was called Umananda. So he apologized to him. "I am so sorry, I hurt your feelings." What humility. One can't imagine. Such a great person he was. And once he asked one of the inmates of Udbodhan, he had done something wrong. Therefore he said, "You go away from here to Belur Math." He did not go at all. Then in the evening he saw him, he was moving about there. "I asked you to go away, you are not gone." He said, "No, I did not go." "Why did you not go? You did not obey me? He said, "No, I am here to serve Holy Mother. That's why I did not go." "Is it so? We are also here to serve Mother only." "All right, you be there." He forgot about his order. So when he says, "I serve Mother," "We are also here for serving Mother." "All right, you are also here. All right, let us serve together." That was Sarat Maharaj. Then three children of Yoginma. Yoginma was associated with Holy Mother in Dakshineshwar. Sri Ramakrishna used to love her very much. And she was perhaps the first attendant to Holy Mother in Dakshineshwar. And she was a widow and she had a child, one daughter. And daughter, three sons were there, small boys. She left, leaving three daughters, she passed away. Then only Yoginma became very disconsolate. She came to Sri Ramakrishna and became a follower of him and Holy Mother's attendant. These three children she had to bring up. And all the while she was there in Udbodhan with mother. So those children also would be in the ashram. They were also become the inmates, these three boys, small, small fellows. All the three were taken care of by Sharkumara. A monk taking care of three small children of Yoginma. Until Yoginma passed away, until he passed away, they were in Udbodhan. And one small fellow, he could not bear any cold. So he could not allow any windows to be opened in the night. But Sharat Maharaj wanted all the air. So he wanted a lot of air because he was lot of overweight was there. So he required a lot of air. But because of the small child, he cannot bear to close all the windows and suffer. Which mother would suffer, I don't know. Whether mother would suffer. He had such a motherly heart. All the three children he brought up with so much of patience. And in administration of the mission also, so many things were there. One of the very dangerous thing was, the British government started doubting the Ramakrishna mission, saying that we are accommodating young people who are all terrorists, who are all carrying on a armed movement against the government. So we are sheltering them. That was one of the charge. So this went to the highest level there, and the Governor General Carmichael at that time, he issued a statement saying that organizations like Ramakrishna Mission, they are sheltering revolutionaries who are fighting against the British. As soon as he announced it, the whole government became against the mission, and police started coming to our mission morning and evening, inspecting who are all inside. Any new person has come, any old person has left this one. They wanted to take the number in the morning and in the evening. So harassment to the police became too much. Then Sharat Maharaj said, if this continues, nobody will come and join here. No young men will come. Even public will not come. When police are harassing morning and evening, who would come here? So public also will not come. The mutt will have to close down. Therefore, he went to mother, holy mother, and then said, mother, there is only one way of getting out of the trouble. Let us send away all these brahmacharis. We shall not have any brahmacharis at all. Only we few swamis will be here, and then the government will not at that time have any objection. So, well, let us send these brahmacharis away. Then mother said, Sharat, those brahmacharis have come not to you or to me. They have come to Sri Ramakrishna. Sri Ramakrishna's door is always open to everyone. You can't close it. Nobody has any right. He is Jagannath. His door is open to everyone. Good, bad, indifferent, everybody will come. You can't send them back. So Sharat Maharaj was in a fix. Unless they are sent away, he cannot save the mission. If we want to save the mission, he has to send them away, and mother is against it. What to do? Then mother herself suggested to him, why don't you meet Carmichael, Governor General, and explain our mission to him. Our mission is wedded to non-violence, wedded to peace, wedded to harmony of religion, wedded to spirituality. We don't have anything to do with politics. Why don't you go and speak about this work to Carmichael? Sharat Maharaj was stunned and amazed about the intelligence of mother. She is giving a socio-political solution. This lady who did not know anything about either social or political situation, she gave the best counsel. Sharat Maharaj was stunned. How did this idea not strike me? Immediately he took the help of Miss MacLeod, that American disciple of Swamiji. She fixed up an engagement with the Governor General, spoke to him plainly, and the Governor General was moved. I should not have issued a statement like that. The next day he issued, so recanting his statement. No, I did not mean anything about Ramakrishna Mission. They are doing excellent work. So I have nothing against them. So all people also should have nothing against them. So the whole thing was undone, and big things became normal. And it was Sharat Maharaj who could do that. He said like that, and he was so kind to everybody inside and outside. His time went away in serving others, serving the mission, serving mother. And mother used to call him, he is my Vasuki. He is always helping me in every way. So mother used to say, the great heart of Sharat Maharaj is next only to Swami Vivekananda. Next to Naren, if anybody has got that ocean of compassion in his heart, it is Sharat. So she used to appreciate Sharat. Once mother was so much moved by the love and affectionate service of Sharat, she told one of her disciples, "I feel like taking Sharat in my shoulders like a baby and go around all the three worlds." So she was so much pleased with Sharat Maharaj. In 1922, Swami Brahmananji passed away, president of the order. So next choice fell upon Sharat Maharaj. All people wanted Sharat Maharaj to become the president. So when he came to Belur Math, all the Swami said, "You will be our next president." Then Sharat Maharaj said, "No, I cannot become your president. Why? Swamiji has given me this general secretaryship. This I will not relinquish. Until I will die as only general secretary. I don't want any other position than that which has been given to me by Swami." So he continued as the general secretary till 1927. From 1925, he retired from all works. And people said, "Will you not work anymore?" He said, "No, until Sri Ramakrishna gives me direct order again. So you do this, you do that, and gives me that power, my work is over. I think my mission is complete now. I have nothing more to do here." And 1926, he held the first convention of all the devotees and the monks of the order, the first general convention of Math and Mission. People from West also came, all our Swamis from West came. It was a very great success. In 1927, the last year of the life of Sharat Maharaj, on 6th August, he went to the shrine as usual. He meditated and came back. Again he went into the shrine. Now he sat not before Sri Ramakrishna, he sat before Holy Mother and then meditated. And then he came out. Again he went. Again he sat before Sri Ramakrishna and meditated. Again he came back. Again he went. 3, 4, 5, 6 times. He comes out, again he goes. So he went on meditating like that. And in the evening, afterward he took food, then took a little rest. In the evening, some papers came for his signature. So he told that person who brought that paper, "Keep it there." These were the last words he spoke. Then he went into a very strange coma. He completely stopped speaking. He completely stopped seeing. So people thought he was in coma. But then if prasad was brought to him, he would open his mouth. If the prasad Maharaj prasad, so he will open his mouth. So Mahaput Maharaj, when he heard this, he said, "That means he is not in coma, he is in deep samadhi. He is in deep samadhi, he comes down from samadhi, goes back into samadhi." And then after 13 days being in that state, then he passed away on 19th at 2 AM early morning and attained Mahasamadhi. So Sharat Maharaj's life is a saga of service, saga of compassion, saga of highest spiritual practice also. He was a master, just like Swami Vivekananda wanted that we should be masters of all the four yogas. He had mastered all the four yogas. He was a Karma Yogin, he was a Bhakti Yogin, he was a Raj Yogin, and he was also a Jnana Yogin. All blended together. And he was the only unique disciple of Sri Ramakrishna, monastic disciple, who could serve both the master and the mother till the end. He served master till the end, served mother till the end. So such a very, very fortunate disciple of Sri Ramakrishna, unique. So we are fortunate to reminisce some of the great incidents from his life. May Sri Ramakrishna, Holy Mother, Swamiji, and Swami Sharadananji bless us all, so that we can digest what we have heard and bring some good changes in our life and enjoy the benefits of that.
Niranjanam nityam ananta rupam bhaktanukampadhrita vigraham vai ईशावतारं परमेशमिड्यं तं रामकृष्णं शिरसा नमामि।